This evening on The Rock Newman Show, we'll delve into the Haitian Revolution, the only successful slave revolt in the Americas, with a special look at the new documentary, 1804, The Hidden History of Haiti. That's coming up on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. The importance and impact of the Haitian Revolution is woefully underestimated and much ignored. A new documentary called 1804, The Hidden History of Haiti, has been produced to set the record straight. Here's part of the trailer.
There's nothing that happens after the Haitian Revolution and our fight for freedom across the Caribbean and North and South America that wasn't influenced by the Haitian Revolution.
The African people on the island fought all the largest armies of the world at the time and won over each one of them. Whooped the Spaniards, beat up the French, knocked down the British.
The Haitians have a pride about them. They revolution is the most important thing to them. The first thing they instill in you is that you are the first Black Republic.
1804 becomes important because it's the date at which the implementation of the dream of real revolution and real equality and new nation status and the ability to defend your new nation is manifest.
When you look at modern historians, when they talk about victories that Europeans had over non-white people, they always frame the narrative as victories. But when African people rise up and fight off their European oppressors, they frame the narrative as a massacre.
Africans everywhere that were enslaved resisted it. Haiti becomes significant because it was the first time in human history that an enslaved population actually overthrew their oppressors.
Joining us now are Tariq Nasheed, the film's producer, and Ezili Danto, executive director of the Haitian Lawyers Leadership Network. Let me say that this is a broadcast, it's a show, that I have long wanted to do. Since I was a student at Howard University in the early 1970s, I came upon some information, did a little reading, had some conversations that made me think then that Haiti and its history probably was perhaps the most maligned, misunderstood, negatively propagandized nation on earth. I've had that feeling for a very long time. When I became aware that you, Tariq Nasheed, that you were doing a movie titled 1804 about the revolution, that was very exciting.
Yes.
When I have been reading you, Ezili Danto, for going on 8 or 9 years now since I met you in Chicago.
That's right.
Your writings have been revolutionary and brilliant. And an opportunity to do something here at the Mecca, Howard University, WHUT-TV, it is something that is thrilling. It gives me a great honor to have you both.
Thank you.
So let's get into this. First thing I want to do with you, Tariq, mm-hmm. is to deal a little bit with process. Mm. You produced this movie. You got it funded. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, if you would compare and contrast, you did very successful filmmaking with the Hidden
Colors.
Hidden Colors documentaries. If you can compare and contrast that process with the process of making this movie about the Haitian Revolution.
Well, the Hidden Colors series, you know, we hit on a lot of different topics in those films. Mm-hmm. And this is an offshoot of the Hidden Colors series. This is the first film that I've done where we're talking about one specific topic. Mm-hmm. And I wanted that topic to definitely be Haiti first, because that's a very important history, not just for the Haitian people, but just for African people globally, because it is an African story. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was very important to show this generation of how the Haitian people stood up against systematic racism, how they stood up to superpowers, mm-hmm. and how that information has been deliberately suppressed. Mm-hmm. You know, for a long time, people have been talking about doing a movie about Haiti and the Haitian Revolution, mm-hmm. and there's always roadblocks. Mm-hmm. I know Danny Glover was trying to do a movie about Haiti for a long time. Mm-hmm. Hollywood told Danny Glover that they're not going to fund his movie because there are no white heroes in it. Mm-hmm. But there's no white heroes in the story.
Yeah.
So we wanted to tell that story without having to go to the dominant society mm-hmm. telling us that we need to interject falsehoods in the story. Uh-huh. So we got the resources together. And
they wanted you to take dramatic license and tell a lie.
Oh, yeah. If they would have had Tom Hanks's Toussaint Louverture.
Yeah. So, Ezeli Danto, as we talk about 1804, I think it is critically important for my viewers and the rest of the world to have an appreciation for what Haiti was, what it represented as a landmass, as a people, and as an invaluable property that caused these superpowers to enslave and bring folks to Haiti, and then to fight each other viciously. So if we can go sort of way back in recorded time for Haiti and start sort of at the beginning, your thoughts about and your commentary about your home.
Thank you for asking me. And it's such a pleasure to be sitting here with this wonderful guy who did just an extraordinary piece of work. Mm-hmm. And I thank you for having me. Haiti was the first place in the Americas where Christopher Columbus put his first colony. Mm-hmm. So he got there in December 1492.
I do notice you didn't say discovered.
No.
Exactly.
He got there, and one of his ships had shipwrecked, and he left a bunch of males there. And when he came back, they were killed. The reason they were killed, he started something called Fort Navidad. So in the Americas, this is the place where the Mahafa started. This is where our Holocaust started, mm-hmm. right? So it started in Haiti. So we have Christopher Columbus being given this opportunity to find spice in India, and he lands in Haiti. He finds in that space what they call the Tainos, okay? That they're Meridians in terms of, you know, the European history. Mm-hmm. But I want to tell you first that Black are original to planet Earth, and they were there in the Americas before Columbus came. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So there were about three different Black groups there. There was the Black Caracoles, there was the Black Aguinis, mm-hmm. and the Black Arguejos, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. But when he landed in a space that was ruled by a cacique, a noble named Guacanagarique. And essentially for the first 15 years, there was absolute genocide. He came in, he saw that he was looking for gold, yeah. And essentially they raped the people, they killed them, all looking for this gold. And that's something that goes on all the way till today in 2017. Mm-hmm. Yes? So what we have to understand, the larger story, because European story starts with what they call the discovery.
Yeah, recorded time.
This is their recorded time, mm-hmm. okay? But for us to understand what was going on in the world at that time, this was 1492, the fall of Grenada, mm-hmm. right? So the first boatload of Africans that landed there as slaves or brought in as enslavement came out of the Iberian Peninsula, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. And for that time, so essentially, when Christopher Columbus got to Haiti, that's the name, Haiti, of the island. Mm-hmm. It had actually three different names, Boyeo, Haiti, and Quisqueya. Mm-hmm. But the more popular name was Haiti. Mm-hmm. What we teach at the Free Haiti Movement that I lead is that Haiti is both a Fon language word and an Amerindian word. So it means sacred highland. Mm-hmm. And this is really important to understand what this landmass means. The landmass is over 1 billion years old. They came in, it's a mountainous area. Mm-hmm. And what they wanted was gold.
Yeah.
And essentially he came back and they set up, they killed the Indians. Within 15 years, they had killed over 1 million people. The people fought back. First person to remember is a woman named Ana Kaona. Her husband was named Kana.
You know what? Let me stop you there because, you know, this is exactly what I wanted you to do, but I want to make sure our audience is getting it. Mm-hmm. You said over a 15-year period of time, mm-hmm. over 1 million people were killed. A very serious genocide started there.
That's right.
Okay.
That's where the genocide started in the Americas, and mm-hmm. it literally hasn't stopped. Mm-hmm. Because they went from there all the way to, so the Portuguese, the Spanish, and then the French and English got involved. Mm-hmm. And so those European tribes spent a lot of time taking other people's lands and mm-hmm. calling
okay,
it
so
discovery.
So they're in Haiti. Mm-hmm. Part of what I want to understand is you have a population there that's mm-hmm. like 1 million people.
Yes.
Columbus comes in 1492,
mm-hmm. yes.
15 years, there's 1 million Haitians killed. How was it, what's the answer to how was it that a much smaller number of people were able to slaughter a much larger number of people? Was it their weapons, their guns, and the Haitian people not thinking that war is set upon them?
Precisely. It's the same reason that the European continues to do this, because the evil of someone coming in and wanting gold and valuing gold better than a human life
sure.
was mm-hmm. something that the natives of the original folks on the planet never quite understood.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, they did have, they use various ways of killing the people.
Superior
they use
weaponry.
The same thing they always use.
And also
gun.
Deception. Deception.
Yeah, uh-huh. deception.
Because the native people welcome them. You uh-huh. know, hey, we'll help you.
Sure.
If you're shipwrecked, we'll feed you, we'll give you, you know, we'll sure. get you back right. Yeah. And they repay them by enslaving them and killing them.
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
we're not used to that type of deception
mm-hmm.
as indigenous people globally.
Mm-hmm.
When the white supremacists left Europe, we didn't understand the level of evil that they had
yeah.
on them.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we still don't understand to this day.
Mm-hmm.
So, but the Haitian Revolution was about them understanding. They knew, like Dessalines, yeah, he knew.
Right.
And he said, I'm not going to fall for the same
yeah,
tricks
yeah,
that,
yeah.
you know,
yeah, and
everybody
we're gonna
else.
Come up
we're
to that,
that,
but I did just want to, you know,
yeah,
kind of
so they
that.
Use diseases,
yes,
smallpox blankets.
Yeah.
They use guns.
Mm-hmm.
And they use all kinds of rape.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they took some of the folks like and brought them to Spain. One of the Ana Kaona's husband was taken, and he died on his way to Spain, as if they were like zoo animals. Like,
mm-hmm.
here's what we have discovered,
mm-hmm.
and they put the people to work in a manner to get them gold, and a lot of the folks, the Taínos refused,
mm-hmm.
and would rather not.
Mm-hmm.
So they fought back. They really fought back, but they had superior weapons, and they used smallpox blankets and essentially gave the people diseases. And mm-hmm. it's still happening today, mm-hmm. right?
And so part of what I think is important for the audience to stand and anybody that's paying attention to this subject matter is, you know, like today within just within the African American community,
mm-hmm.
You know, I saw something just recently talking about, you know, how ridiculous it is for colorism, that light versus dark and dark versus light and that sort of thing. And something that started to happen very early on would be the impregnation, the rape, mm-hmm. and the impregnation of masses of women, mm-hmm. creating mulattoes, mm-hmm. mulattoes who were given a certain latitude well above the Africans and what ultimately became the enslaved, so that between now what would be the imperialist and ultimately the slave master, mm-hmm. was a mulatto population that helped keep in check the Africans. And so therefore, color and race was interjected mm-hmm. very early in the process.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if we're looking chronologically, so he gets there in 1492. By 1503, he's basically annihilated most of the population. And then there's a priest that's named Bartholomew de la Casa. He starts championing the folks that are dying and asks the Pope to allow him to bring in Africans. So in 1503, they started bringing in Africans as captives to work the plantations. Mm-hmm. So the Africans came, and that's when you start having what you're talking about, because mm-hmm. the white man is the biggest rapist on the planet. So they raped the people. But in Haiti, though, it was, the lifespan was about 6 years, because they work the people yeah. to death.
The lifespan of the slaves brought in.
Right. Yeah. So you right. have a priest, a Dominican priest, that says, you know, I'm going to champion these Tainos. Let's bring in the Africans, because they stronger, they won't die. And mm-hmm. they brought the Africans, and that's mm-hmm. when the, you know, my ancestors got to Haiti in mm-hmm. 1503. Mm-hmm. And then it took 300 years, from 1503 to 1804. Mm-hmm. For 300 years, the Africans were enslaved, mm-hmm. and they didn't get their freedom until 1804.
Sorry. And so with what she just said there,
yeah.
it would be, it wouldn't be a human quality, not for those of some consciousness, not to have internalized what had happened to them. Mm-hmm. How much in researching this movie did you find that what would have been decades and centuries of hostility played into the relentlessness of those who were willing to fight to death for their freedom?
Great question, Andy. My sister just mentioned that the lifespan was very short for the Africans who reached the island.
Yeah.
And that became a gift and a curse, because what would happen, they would have to bring over so many new African people, and they would retain a lot of the African culture, the African fighting skills, the African history, and that worked against the French eventually. Mm-hmm. So that's why a lot of people, they knew how to tap back into the voodoo, they knew how to tap back into the spiritual systems and the fighting systems, and they played on that.
Yeah, so let's take a look at some of the taxes of what you guys are touching upon.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
There is no two ways. This man only understands force. So only with force can we talk back to him. And some people started saying, well, but we don't have boats, we don't have guns, we don't have this, we don't have that. And one of the answers that was given is, God has never created a creature and not give you a way to fight. You sit on a stone, it is a tool while it's holding your body. But when you are attacked, you have your weapon under your butt. Use it.
When it comes to guerrilla warfare, and this is what the Haitian Revolution is a lesson in, we have to understand how guerrilla warfare works. When you're going up against a superpower, you can't go head up. You have to attack the flanks, you have to attack from the back, and you have to learn how to weaponize everything. So the Haitians, they learn how to weaponize nature, weaponize rocks, weaponize trees, weaponize animals. Understand that, because when they had the first voodoo ceremony, they had that in an alligator swamp. Now, they knew that the white supremacists weren't going to no alligator swamp, but they were just so in touch with nature, they knew they needed to weaponize everything.
Something so extraordinarily tragic is what you mentioned about the enslaved Africans that were brought in. Mm-hmm. Their typical lifespan after they hit Haiti was 6 years. And that was as a result of the quintessential inhumane conditions of which they work, how hard they had to work, how they were driven to produce, and the again, inhumane beatings that they received at the drop of a hat. So that's one thing. So you've got these, in essence, men that are coming in as slaves, receiving this kind of treatment, short lifespan after they get there. And there was a system started at some point that allowed women to have multiple husbands that helped produce more offspring to do the work of the colonizers. There was a period there. Now, can you talk to us during this time about the women's participation in the struggle?
So they actually captured not just males, but women. And so, but from the beginning, the Africans would not be enslaved, so they fought. The Igbos, for instance, were so powerful that the European essentially forbid getting Igbos, it's the tribe of the Igbos, because they would rather commit suicide than be slaves. And many, many Haitians, Africans who would become Haitians, whenever they got off that boat, a lot of them ran away and went into the mountains. So they were there were maroon colonies inside of Haiti. And so the plantations was in the plains. And so you have hundreds of years of these, there's caves in Haiti, living in the caves. In this space, by 1791, in this space, there rose these women. These women, a lot of them, for instance, you know, were fighting in Angola, Queen Nzinga, people of Queen Nzinga, right? As a matter of fact, in Haiti, the name for Queen Nzinga is Mumble Inun. It's still there, and it, and there's a Lakou, you know, because the Africans came and brought their culture, what was in their heads. And this is critically important because at the end of the day, it was in their heads and what they brought with them that gave them the ability to beat three European powers. So in that space, you have people like Zabeth, who died at 22. She was a woman who so refused to be a slave that when she was like by 15, she had escaped so many times. They ended up, you know, they would break you at the wheel. They would tie two horses together and wrench you apart.
Break at the wheel. We're actually going to help get that defined.
They would bury you alive and let ants eat your head for like weeks until you died. They did so the horrors of that system that it came to be that one woman, for instance, her name is Tantoya. She was the woman that taught Jean-Jacques Dessalines how to fight. I mean, Jean-Jacques Dessalines would become the greatest hero because he won the Haiti Revolution.
Let me stop you for a second.
Yes.
Because when you're talking about a woman who taught the man how to fight, we want to take a look at a clip here.
The sisters, in many ways, supplied the force, created the environment for the men to do what needed to be done. Sisters are very important to any revolution. In fact, ain't nobody having a revolution without women. In fact, if you think you're doing that, it's just a fight. It ain't a revolution.
Sani Belair, for instance, when they caught her, her husband was General Charles Belair, right? And he negotiated for her release. And you know, these white settlers, they never, you know, they betray whatever. They have no honor, okay? So when he gave himself up, they took both of them, okay? So that's Sanit Belair and Charles Belair, the general. And so they sentenced her to a beheading because she was a woman, and then they sent him to get shot. And she refused. She said, "I will die the honorable way with my husband." They wanted to blindfold her, and she said, "No. You don't need to blindfold me because I'm a woman."
When they ordered to take her head and put it under, they fought and fought with her and couldn't do it. And in the end, she gave the orders. "Soldiers, position. Don't make me wait. Fire."
Tariq.
Yes.
You're the filmmaker here.
Yes.
In order to do this film and to do it justice, you had to dig deep into the history.
Oh, yeah.
And right now, as we're talking about the impact of women, as a black male filmmaker, what did you learn about the women and their participation and support of ultimately what was the rise? Your movie is 1804, Haitian Revolution. So talk to us about
doing the movie,
what you realized. You
know, we were talking about the four male major principles in the movie, but the more I researched, I saw that there were always the sisters right there with them, working in conjunction with the brothers, and I really wanted to get that point across. Even with Mack and Dahl, we talked about him. He was a brother who kicked off what would become the Haitian Revolution. There were women poisoning people that he was instructing people to do, going back to Bookman. When Bookman had the voodoo ceremony, there was a woman who helped him organize that, who really organized it herself, but he was part of that. We talked about, you know, Toussaint, the women who trained him, the women who trained Dessalines. So it was very important to show the women participating in the revolution and how important that was.
As an American, I know Izili is infinitely familiar with the religious practices.
Yes.
But there's no way in the world that you produce this movie and not come across the faith aspect, the religious aspect. What did you learn about the religion in Haiti, Voodoo and the rest?
I learned how so much of it was still really practiced in Africa today, but it's really an African spiritual system. And what I really learned, I learned how it became negative and why it became negative. And this is what I wanted to relay in the movie. I talked about how in old movies in Hollywood, they would portray voodoo as demonic, and they would show the zombies, and they would actually use Haitians or portray Haitians in these old movies to demonize them. So I saw how desperate they were to demonize voodoo. And even now, I showed some clips or a clip of modern preachers talking negatively about Haiti and voodoo and how it's devil worship. And that myth still goes on today. And whenever people in the dominant society are going out of their way to create a myth around us, I know, let me research the truth and see what's really going on. And that's what we did with voodoo. And we had to take that stigma off of it, because a lot of black people, we look at voodoo as something negative.
Absolutely.
And you know what's interesting? If you go to New Orleans, a lot of the Mambos are white women. It's white people going down there. White people going to Haiti learning voodoo. But they got us scared.
Okay, so talk to us about voodoo. Talk to us about the Catholic Church. That is a critically important aspect of Haitian history. Talk to us about its origins and its origins and why its value had to be so propagandized and diminished.
Right, so you had two big Catholic nations fighting for territory, the Portuguese and the Spanish, and the Spanish got to Haiti. And then later on, the French, all Catholic nations, right? So then they got their edict, their laws from the Pope. So the Pope would provide them with lands of the native folks in the Americas. So, on August 14, 1791, there was a ceremony, the Voodoo ceremony that began the Haitian Revolution. So you could say this was the first liberation theologist, except that Voodoo is not a religion. It's a way of life. It's how you are, right?
Voodoo, which people say here, voodoo.
Right, Voodoo. Right. V-O-D-U-N is the way we spell it, right?
Sure.
And it's the most, that's how, you know, it comes from the Fon African language, and it means raising up sacred energies. So it was that, because the irreducible essence of who you are is what we talk about when we say what, there's no word in English for it. So the English might say gods, we call them the Loa. So. And after, look, our ancestors left us a way of being, a way of connecting with nature. So they studied nature, they studied the cycles of the season, and there's a mother, there's a father, there's healing, and they understood after watching millenniums of how they can come into the world that there were some irreducible essences. At Bois Caïman, at this ceremony, there was about 200 warriors. Mm-hmm. A lot of them were Maroons. Mm-hmm. They came to this space. And women in that space, mm-hmm. The priestess, her name was Cécile Fatima. She was the priestess that presided over the war council that began the Haitian Revolution, mm-hmm. Cécile Fatima. Mm-hmm. The reason my name is Ezili Danto,
yeah,
is because Ezili Danto is what Americans or folks would call the Black Mother, mm-hmm. or the Black Madonna, mm-hmm. the original goddess. Mm-hmm. So Ezili Danto is the irreducible essence of all of that which nurtures, which is the female principle, which mm-hmm. gives birth, mm-hmm. okay? Her counterpart is called Ogu. That is the male principle. Mm-hmm. At Bois Caïman and for the Haitian Revolution, Dessalines has become Ogu for us. Mm-hmm. He's the quintessential archetype of a protector, mm-hmm. of a father, mm-hmm. of a husband, of mm-hmm. someone who liberated his country. That's Ogu. Mm-hmm. Ezili Danto was the first irreducible essence that was called up mm-hmm. because our bodies are temples yeah. for sacred energies to come through. Mm-hmm. Sacred energies of our ancestors, mm-hmm. particular archetypes. Mm-hmm. So the female archetype in Haiti mm-hmm. is Ezili Danto. Yeah. If you go into Atlanta, you might say it's the Black Madonna, mm-hmm. the shrine of the Black Madonna, right? Mm-hmm. So essentially, Vodun, all of the tribes came from different spaces in yeah. West Africa, Congo, and Angola, mm-hmm. all the way, right? Mm-hmm. They spoke different languages. Mm-hmm. But at Bois Caïman, they became one. Mm-hmm. That is the only unity in Haiti that's never wavered. Yeah. No Haitian will tell you, I'm from Diomi, they yeah. will say, I am Haitien. Yeah. We became one. Mm-hmm. And in becoming one, mm-hmm. they swore to live free or die. Mm-hmm.
And that is the answer. Mm-hmm. From that essence is a power mm-hmm. that is all-powerful. And so those attempting to oppress must attempt to take that away, mm-hmm. to demonize that, to make that dark and evil.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm.
So, Tariq, let me go back to you as you're preparing to do this movie about the revolution. Mm-hmm. How much of that spirit did you find or did you factor into what ultimately was the success of taking on all of these powerful military forces?
That was very important to relay because the people there, they understood if I physically die, my spirit is going to live on.
Yeah.
So that the fear was gone. Mm-hmm. And without that fear, they mm-hmm. were able to triumph. Mm-hmm. And fear is the only thing that really kept people in check, mm-hmm. even today.
Yeah,
it's psychologically. Yeah. We're African people. We're global. We're the global majority, mm-hmm. and we keep forgetting that we're taught that we're a minority. That's mm-hmm. why the word minority is embedded in our brains mm-hmm. to keep us in a fearful mindset. Mm-hmm. But the Haitian people, they were the ones who really got that fear out of their system, and they were the only African people really to get out of slavery mm-hmm. and overthrow their oppressors. Mm-hmm. And it was because of that spiritual system being intact and that mm-hmm. fear being gone and yeah. them understanding that they are going to live on.
I'd like for you to respond to an aha moment that I had.
Yes.
So I sit straight up in the bed mm-hmm. as I was preparing and thinking about this show and wanting to do it justice. And I thought, how powerful and successful, to a large extent, that the colonizers were in trying to devalue this spirit that you're talking about mm-hmm. here, this oneness, this all-powerfulness. Mm-hmm. And what I thought was, because had they not been successful to the degree they were, that in 1960 and 70 and 80 and 90, the masses of South Africans way, way outnumbered the oppressors. Had they understood this particular essence and this powerfulness, they would have risen up and taken over their country.
Absolutely. And I've been to South Africa and I've asked that same question. How are they allowing this to happen? I've been to the townships in South Africa, and what I noticed, they have them divided. You have black South Africans. I'm from this tribe.
Yeah,
I'm from
mulatto, that tribe. Color.
Mulatto, the coloreds live there. The blacks live here. Mm-hmm. So it's that division that they keep implementing on us that we fall for every time.
Mm-hmm. Julie, so the ceremony took place, and it was the what you term, in essence, the trigger of the revolution, because the movie's titled 1804.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But it was years before that.
And you know, it's funny, a lot of people, after they saw the movie, they were like, I didn't know that it was a whole process.
Yeah.
A lot of people thought that it was like something that happened in a week in 1804, and they just overthrew them overnight. And people don't realize that it was like a 12-year process, right?
Yes.
And what I'd like for you to do as the filmmaker, and then you as the homegirl historian, is I'd like for you to share, I'd like for you to share from that time, from that 1791, what you learned in making this film about what the process was, how it happened.
What I learned is that the process was about having the end goal, that's the leadership. Because see, a lot of times with us now, we're taught to just follow one leader, and when that leader gets killed, the whole movement dies. They didn't let that happen. They said freedom, that's our leadership right there. We're going to be free no matter what. So if somebody dies, we're still going to keep the revolution going on. We're going to keep the process going on. That was very significant. And I learned a lot from that.
So if you can share to your level of memory and understanding from that 1791 time, take us through that decade.
Okay. So what I think really Tariq did such a beautiful job of showing is that we fight from one generation to the next. We build from one generation to the next. And it's all about the eternal, not the carnal. So
explain that for me.
Okay. So bullets are dust was the chant before they ran into the cannons of the Europeans. They literally went and put their bodies in the cannons and got blown up. But they were stopping. They were going to stop this terror because they did not want Tariq, you and I to have to face this terror.
Terror which now had been perpetrated over the course of nearly
300 years. All right. So what people have to understand is that the African in Haiti understood what was eternal. And so it was about the collective, and death was meaningless because it only meant they were going back to the eternal, back to the ancestors. So if I die, it's the way I live that matters, because the universe is about vibration, and I'm going to lift up the eternal vibration, not the individual gain vibration. And I think, I know that Tariq really, really pushed that point, and that was one of really important point for folks to understand. So you have Cecile Fatima the Mambo, just like, you know the story of the Isis or Aset, Horus, and Heru?
Sure.
And who chooses the leader. That's what Cecile Fatima, who was the priestess Ebwa Kaima, the Vodun ceremony that began the only successful slave revolt in human history, period. She chose who would lead that revolution, and it was a man named Bookman Duty out of, he originally was from Jamaica.
So she chose him.
And now, there were 200 other warriors there, and her word was bond. She chose him.
Okay, so Tariq, let me come back to you for a second.
Sir.
Okay, because she said it was obviously important for you to highlight the willingness to fight, the struggle, and the what was the fearlessness as a result of understanding that those who were struggling were for affinity, if you will. Tell us the importance of you capturing that.
It was important to capture that, and it was important to go into Bookman. She just mentioned Bookman, and in his very infamous and famous speech at Bwakwaema, he said, We got to get rid of the white gods. That's the first thing he said, one of the first things. Mm-hmm. Get rid of that. We got to, that's out. Mm-hmm. And that's very important, because what he was saying is you got to get the system of white supremacy out of your mind. Mm-hmm. You get that out of here. Let's mm-hmm. go back to who we really are.
Yeah.
Because this is not how we're supposed to live. Mm-hmm. We're making mm-hmm. these people rich. They're beating us. They're killing us. They're maiming us. They're mm-hmm. raping us. Mm-hmm. Enough is enough. I mean, mm-hmm. they burned him up. That's yeah. why he was called Bookman. We yeah. emphasize that in the movie.
Yeah.
So he understood torture. He understood brutality. His yeah. mother was a revolutionary.
I was about to ask you, do you know what was the impetus of his consciousness?
It is those mothers, those women. It was a lot of those brothers. It was the women giving them that consciousness. That's mm-hmm. why they've always attacked sisters first. Mm-hmm. They always go for the mother first, because mm-hmm. if they can control the mother, mm-hmm. you got the children. Mm-hmm. They do that now. Mm-hmm. You understand?
You think like a wacky congressman from Florida? you see?
Yeah. Exactly. Anytime black women challenge white supremacy, mm-hmm. look at what they do. Mm-hmm. You know, look at Trump and all those people.
Yeah.
So they've always had this thing about attacking the black mother, the black female, and mm-hmm. the reason why they don't want to create Dessalines and Bookmans out uh-huh. here.
So talk to me a little bit about, because inevitably in any kind of struggle like this, mm-hmm. there are those who should be on the side of struggle, who would benefit from the righteousness of a righteous struggle, mm-hmm. who join the other side. Mm-hmm. Talk to us a little bit about what the challenges were from those within, from the trouble within.
Okay, so Tariq just kind of alluded to something that's really important that folks must understand. So when that revolution started, there was a decree. So it was called the Bookman's Prayer. Mm-hmm. And essentially he says that the white man's God wants to do crimes. The God within me, and this is why I became a voterist. He said, the God within me wants to do good. So we knew that God was within, you see? And so you have this I think it was Malcolm X who said that the Negro Revolution is run by foxy white liberals, mm-hmm. and that the Black Revolution is run by God, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. Bookman said something. So the God within you, he says, listen to the voice of liberty that's within, mm-hmm. all right? So we're talking about a spiritual people who had no fear of death, who ran into cannons. And at that point, you have two things to remember. The Wakayima call. It was in a Kikongo language. Remember, they all spoke different languages, mm-hmm. but they got together, and this was the call. A Mbumba, Kanga Mandele, Kanga Bafyoti, Kanga Najoki, Kanga Yo. And what it meant is that the Supreme God, the Master of Breath,
yeah.
will give us the strength mm-hmm. to take our liberty, and to do three things. And mm-hmm. this is what I have worked on my entire life mm-hmm. to bring to the universe, to the black world, the call at Bwakaima. And it was that we have to stop the colonists, stop his black collaborators, and stop all his evil forces. His evil forces was defined, to give you a parallel, what Neely Fuller calls the nine areas of activity. So mm-hmm. essentially, as Dr. Henry Clark says, every level of activity is used for domination mm-hmm. by the Western mm-hmm. Eurasians. Mm-hmm. So, but that was the template. Mm-hmm. So if we're looking for ancestral wisdom, that's the template. Mm-hmm. The template is, and today, we're dealing with the same thing. We're under occupation in Haiti, but what is the evil forces? Back then, it was the military, the guns, the disease, the media, mm-hmm. the way of their entertainment. It's still the same. Mm-hmm. Neely Fuller calls it economic entertainment, law, labor, war, sex, mm-hmm. politics.
Right. Okay. Tariq, if you now would go into and explain through all the time that you've been working with this. Mm-hmm. We now are at a time when freedom is demanded. I'm gonna say that as opposed to war is declared.
Right.
When
right.
freedom is demanded, mm-hmm. liberation mm-hmm. is the goal.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
What were the tactics that allowed a population who now were facing trained armies mm-hmm. armed with the most powerful weapons known to mankind at this time. Mm-hmm. So you got a population who basically have none of the advanced weaponry of 1791. So how did it happen?
And they learned how to weaponize everything. And the first thing you weaponize is your mind.
Okay.
And a military brother taught me this. The military is here. It's not about the weapons you have.
Mm-hmm.
It goes back to the Rambo movies. Mm-hmm. The Rambo movies, it tries to show you how you can weaponize everything. The Sylvester Stallone character, they drop him off in the jungle and he gets bamboo and he fights all these forces.
Yeah.
The Haitians did that. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what they did. They weaponized rocks, trees, animals. They weaponized everything, and their mind was weaponized. So anytime they came in contact with the white supremacists, mm-hmm. they knew it, wartime was there. So they're going to do something to protect themselves, to get liberated. So that was the thing. They weaponized everything.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very important to understand, because see, the white supremacists knew how to weaponize everything.
Yeah.
When Moore is actually brought in the fire stick into Africa, I mean into Europe.
Uh-huh.
They brought that in from Asia.
Right.
And unfortunately, the Moors were using it for celebratory reasons. They were
uh-huh.
using it as like firecrackers, but the Europeans, they said, okay, we can use this to kill people.
Yeah.
So the Europeans knew how to weaponize everything, and we started to wane from that, but the Africans in Haiti, they picked back up on that concept, and that's what got them a stronger foothold.
So they didn't have, they couldn't text each other.
No.
Didn't have no cell phone. Are you able to talk about, either one of you, to be able to talk about what was the ability to coalesce when there was no ability for those in the city necessarily to talk to those in the hills and the countryside?
See, they got on code. That's the thing.
Talk to me about
the code. Being on code is very important.
Okay.
You know, in the black community, you remember back in the day before the internet, mm-hmm. we can learn a dance in Alabama and that dance would be in Detroit a week later.
Right. Uh-huh.
We knew how to get stuff going on through the grapevine. We knew how to communicate with
each other. Sort of kind of like, you know, if you walk into the barber shop and somebody say, "What's up?" and dude go,
mm-hmm.
and said, person that said, "What's up?" said, "I hear you."
Yeah.
That kind of code.
Exactly. We had a code, and we know we how to have a code now. A lot of times we don't have a code when it comes to freeing ourselves now.
Mm-hmm.
But back then, all of them, they had a code. They got on code because white supremacy works by code.
Yeah.
A white supremacist in Europe is going to think the same way as a white supremacist here, and a white supremacist here will think like the same white supremacist in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
So they all have a code of conduct when it comes to dominating people.
Did you delve into particular battles in particular regions at all? Did you?
I think some of the stuff we did talk about certain battles that happened
mm-hmm.
in Haiti, but we just talked about the whole revolution as a whole
mm-hmm.
and really the mindset that went into mm-hmm. kicking it off. And
I see
and
that, and I see that that's something that you are paying particular mm-hmm. attention to stressing, and that is the mindset.
Yes.
But so it's really for all the study that you've done,
mm-hmm.
I'm curious if you are familiar with a few of the pivotal battles.
Yes, I am. And what Tariq was talking about is so important. The geography was used.
Mm-hmm.
Haiti's
mm-hmm.
a land of mountains.
Yeah.
So there is a battle at Crête à Pierrot.
Mm-hmm.
And in this battle, the Africans were outnumbered. I mean, outnumbered. Let's say there was 500 to 1,000 Africans in this fort.
Mm-hmm.
And there was like 15,000 Frenchmen,
mm-hmm.
right? And there was a siege.
Yeah.
And there's a famous woman, her name is Marie-Jeanne. She was actually she led a bodyguard. She was the bodyguard for Dessalines,
mm-hmm.
you know, when he became emperor and had won the revolution. So they use the space that they were in. Dessalines went and said, those of you who want to remain a slave to France, if you want to, then leave this fort.
Yeah.
But those of you who want to die free men,
yeah.
stand with me.
Yeah.
And that was the kind of mindset.
Mm-hmm.
But they got out of there because there were caves underground.
Mm-hmm.
They also fought, sometimes the French was here and all of a sudden they found, you know, the Africans that was in front of them, they found
mm-hmm.
another battalion in the back of them
mm-hmm.
because they went underground like they
mm-hmm.
did in Vietnam, and I think he talked about this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Haiti's the land of mountains.
Mm-hmm.
So there's ways to go through those mountains
mm-hmm.
that the Africans understood. So mm-hmm. they used that space.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I'm a master Haitian dancer.
Mm-hmm.
They use their physicality,
mm-hmm.
right? So the the French had these called les épaules. They had like
these tussles things.
Tussles, yeah. Like uh-huh. What you see with Garvey. You mentioned
yeah, yes,
that,
yes, yes,
right?
Yes.
They had yeah. that the shoulders, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's a Haitian dance that's called épaules. Mm-hmm. So they didn't have to talk. All they had to do is go like this. Everybody knew the French was coming.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Also, we used the conch, and mm-hmm. the drums.
Mm-hmm.
So in Vodun, for the different archetypes, right?
Okay.
So there's a certain beat to call up Ezili.
Mm-hmm.
There's a certain beat to call up Ogu.
Mm-hmm.
There's a certain beat to talk to Ligba, which is the
mm-hmm.
opener.
Mm-hmm.
So they spoke those language this to each other from way distances.
This is all the code that he's talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That the enslaved understood.
They understood.
But the slave
didn't understand
didn't
it.
Understand.
That's right. Right. So that was part of that code. Of course, the final battle was called the Battle of Verchères.
Mm-hmm.
And it was November 18th. It's coming up, and this is what we do at the Free Haiti Movement. We know that our culture is our sword,
mm-hmm.
and because we're under occupation right now
mm-hmm.
in 2004, and they came back mm-hmm. on the 200th anniversary of our independence,
mm-hmm.
and they brought the French, the first time the French came into Haiti after 200 years
yeah.
was in 2004.
Yeah, we're gonna get
okay,
to that
got it.
Next time around.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. There were 200,000 at least, 200 in fighting for this liberation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There were 200,000 Haitians that lost their lives.
Right.
It was something like 65,000 total. On the opposite side.
Mm-hmm.
What is the reflection and what is the sense of those who lost their lives for that revolution? What I'm really asking is, have they been given proper credit within the society?
For sacrificing
yes.
themselves.
Yes.
I think they have. I think they have, and I think people respect and appreciate that. And people saw that resilience. People were willing to die for something that they believed in.
Mm-hmm.
People were willing to die to say, I'm not going to be a part of this system. I would rather become an ancestor than go along with this evil system.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that goes back to voodoo. That's what mm-hmm. voodoo is about.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to continue to live on through these other revolutionaries.
Mm-hmm.
So that's very important.
Again, Tariq, as an American
mm-hmm.
who, comparatively speaking,
mm-hmm.
has had the much easier life,
right?
What's your greatest lesson out of doing this film?
There's so many lessons in it. There's so many good lessons in it. But one of the biggest lessons I learned is just how resilient the African mind is when it's going back to our self, what we are, who we are, when we get rid of the European shade that's over us,
mm-hmm.
when we go back to who we really are, we become invincible to a certain degree. And I just learned resilience in a people. I learned how African people can use ingenuity when we're thinking on our own resources.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to Haiti to do the movie,
yeah.
I learned about the Citadel. I never even knew about this place.
Mm-hmm.
The Citadel is this big, huge fortress, and we talked about it in the movie, that's the biggest fortress in the Western Hemisphere. I never knew about it. The media never talked about it,
mm-hmm.
never learned about it in school. But there's
mm-hmm.
this big fort that the Haitians built right after the revolution, all on their own,
mm-hmm.
no European powers, no European help at all.
Mm-hmm.
And they act like it doesn't exist in modern history.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so much that I learned and mm-hmm. I became inspired about.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to get that information to the people.
Yeah. We are going to take a look at the website. And if you can tell us how you could be reached
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
at your lawyers.
Okay. So I had the Haitian Lawyers Leadership Network. You can find me at ezilidanto.com. That's myname.com.
Mm-hmm.
Or on Facebook.
Spell that out slowly, folks.
Okay. Mm-hmm. EZILIDANTO. And mm-hmm. I'm on Twitter, Facebook. We have the Free Haiti Movement page on everywhere, so people can get in touch with me by going through the website.
Uh-huh. Tariq, it was your film debuted last week.
Yes, it did.
And how are we doing?
It's great, man. We had screenings back in October,
mm-hmm.
all sold out all around the world. I was in the UK a couple of weeks ago, sold
yeah.
out over there. People are loving the film. Everybody can get it at 1804movie.com.
Okay. Thank you both so very much for being here.
Absolutely.
This is to be continued.
That's yes. Right.
Happily to be continued. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. Come back next week when we take a look at the political, economic, and natural forces are working against Haiti's success today. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.